Heartiest welcome to our next speaker, Cecilia Nasarre, Vice President Compliance at TIER Mobility, where she leads TIER's compliance, risk, and internal controls programs. She's an accomplished compliance professional with over 8 years' experience in ethics, compliance, and risk management. She has previously served as the Compliance Director for Free Now and the Compliance Manager for Raisin DS, as well as HSBC. In her own words, compliance is all about doing the right thing for the right reasons, and in doing so, we protect the company and its employees. It's about acting fairly and honestly, complying with the law and adhering to high ethical standards in all that we do.
So when I arrived, I discovered I was going after Xavier, which meant stress was going up. But I guess I'm here to talk about fear and courage, so it's appropriate and a good exercise for me. So fear, it's often associated to whistleblowing and speaking up. It's not that easy to send a message or go in the office of a compliance officer or HR professional to raise a concern. They fear retaliation, lack of confidentiality, not being understood, or no action being taken. They sometimes, and I've seen this a few times, they actually are worried about the consequences for the other party. They are worried that they will get in trouble. They know they did something wrong, but they still worry for them. And sometimes I also see that they're worried of spending too much time on it. So it's more of an operational fear versus delivering on their KPIs. And this results in people who witness wrongdoing, you know, staying in the silence. And so what can we as professionals, but also as a company, reduce that fear and help them to speak up? There are two pillars in that answer. One is, I would say, an obvious one and simple, which is the operational one. And the other is more a behavioral one. So I'm not going to spend too much time on the operational one, but just a few things I could say here. By operational one, I mean what the EU directive tells us to do. So having a process whereby people can raise a concern. Often that takes the form of an online tool, but it could take different forms. And so for that, you need a process. The process needs to be clear. People need to know where to go, who to speak to, who does the investigation, what's the SLAs, and so on. And usually companies are quite good at that. Where I think there's some effort to be done is, on top of maybe having a bit more comms, is the actual choice of tool or how to implement it. Often, especially in big corporations, they have this very sophisticated tool that every compliance officer would be super proud of. But for someone who is not familiar with compliance or how to whistleblow, it becomes very complicated. So we need something simple, straight to the point, that doesn't take long. There's often cases where people will build the courage to speak up, start the process, and then abandon in the middle because it just takes too long, or they don't understand the questions, or it's just overly complicated. So you need to simplify that. The other point that I also saw is that you only have one option to speak up. So you often have this tool, even though it's great, that's the only option. And especially in smaller organizations, some people are more comfortable speaking directly to someone. To, you know, so whether it's face-to-face, having a call, video call, it could be Slack, whatever you're using, but some people are just more comfortable in an informal setting. Doesn't mean that informal investigation will not become formal after, depending on what's happening. But at the beginning, at least, people need to have options. And the last point I would make here is research has shown that people feel more comfortable raising an issue as a group, or at least with someone else, right? They have more courage to do it. And so we should, as a corporation or as a compliance officers, give that option. It doesn't, in my experience, it didn't happen that much, but I know it helped a few people to come forward. So I would definitely push for that. So that's for the operational side, and I would say that's the easy one, and usually what companies would follow. Where it becomes more complicated is the behavioral psychology side of it. And that takes much more work, and it's much more than just having a tool. It entails a deep cultural change in how employees perceive the cost of speaking up versus the benefits, especially in an organization where employees feel unsafe, right? The work environment is not safe to speak up. And the answer of why there is censorship is quite easy. It's self-preservation, right? Obvious. They want to protect themselves, protect their job, their salary at the end of the month, their family, their colleagues. It's natural. And so here, the work is working on how they perceive risk versus the outcome and the benefit. The risk is seen as something very immediate and very personal, right? For example, losing their job. They're scared of that. The benefit is seen as a long-term benefit and only for the corporation. And so it's our responsibility, management, top, middle management, supported by a strong compliance function and or people function, to help build a culture around trust so that people can talk. And not necessarily shift completely, but at least make it clear that the risk is not that high, actually. Obviously, that the risk varies depending on the cases. Obviously, if I take the case that was explained by Xavier, we're talking about another level. But we shouldn't forget all those cases that happen, you know, that we don't talk about. But it takes time, right? Working on trust takes time. It's an everyday effort. It means you need to work on several fronts. So it's hard to put in a few minutes, but I'll try to regroup it in four main pillars. The first pillar is unblocking communication, right? Employees need to feel that they are heard, that we're listening to their concerns. What that means basically is first asking questions. And that goes through compliance, but also managers. Very often in fast-growing companies, especially in the tech industry, people are put in management positions without any training. So yes, they're excellent at what they do, the job they were hired for at the beginning, but they were never trained as managers. So people need to be trained to be good managers. And good managers mean they're good at hearing what their teams have to say. They're good at asking for feedback, but also receiving feedback. And that goes through asking questions. What I also try to push is going on the listening tour. So we call it listening tour. But basically, it's pushing managers to go see their teams locally, especially in our current setting where you have a lot of remote work, a lot of companies that have offices a bit everywhere. People need to go and meet the teams. You go with 5-6 questions, you know, no need for more, and just show that you're generally interested in what they have to say. Find out what's working, what's not working, what has been done that should be changed, what are the concerns, and so on. And as a compliance officer, I do the same exercise. I obviously have a different perspective, but I do the same thing. And each time I do that, I get people to speak up. And it's not even more of an effort. So I do one-to-ones with them, with key people, or I go at the coffee break. Coffee breaks are gold mine, right? For this, you get a bit of insights. And that's how you get some info on what happened. It's said casually, but then you can develop on it. And so that's what helped me also to get people to speak up, is showing my face, especially for compliance officers. We are often seen as these scary, mystical people who just, you know, live in their ivory tower and just implement rules. But that's not always... some of them exist, yes, but we're not always like that. And we need to show that we're here to hear what they have to say. We're open, we're respectful, and we'll hear what they have to say. And we'll, you know, take it seriously. So that's for the first pillar, I would say. The second pillar is leading by example, which for me is a big one. So walking the walk is not enough. You need to talk the talk. It's not because you're a top management or you're in a key position that you're exempted from bad behavior or from speaking up. I, as a compliance officer, had my share. different types. All are, you know, if you look at all the unethical behavior, I think I've seen it all, but also as a victim, right? The positive in that is, obviously, I learned from it, but I also can use it as examples, and I often do. Depending on what I'm talking about, I'll just cherry-pick the best example. I actually did 2 weeks ago in my current company, where I was trying to illustrate ethical dilemmas. So I'll give you the story so you get where I'm coming from. This was a couple of years ago. The company I was working for was trying to get more investments. They were very advanced as one of this company, so we organized a face-to-face meeting. On the investor side, there was 3 people, and on our side, we were 10. I was part of those 10 people in a scene that looked shockingly like this photo from Wolf of Wall Street. And why? It's because I was the only woman. And this is relevant for what's coming after. What's also relevant is that we had a couple of discrimination cases against women in that company. Anyways, going back to what was happening, they all get excited, going for the question, everything goes well. I get excited because everything goes well as well. And then just before the coffee break, we have this last question about diversity. And so one of these, you know, important-looking investors say, I would love to hear your comments about your woman/man ratio, you know, in this company. And before you do, I have 2 comments. His first comment was about the figures. So HR had shared the actual stats, and they were bad, objectively. We were, you know, not many women, and especially in manager positions. It was mainly men. His second comment, though, was, and I'm quoting here, you obviously have 10 people here, your top 10 people, and you only have 1 woman. Wait. So you can imagine, you know, how I was, mentally as well. And there, the C-suite got a bit destabilized and became a bit defensive. And their first reaction was, no, we're not discriminating against women. And then they pointed to me, saying something like, oh, Cecilia will vouch or confirm. And there, that half second that followed was very intense, only a second, but still. Everyone in the room was looking at their table or, you know, nodding. And in half a second, I thought to myself, why don't I just nod as well, right? This will just go away. But then I was saved from the gong. The investor had his phone on the table, and it rang. And it was a super important call. So he said, Cecilia, hold that thought. Let's go on a coffee break now, and then we'll resume. Yes. And so we exit the room, and I actually had the opportunity to step back, right? And that's when you make a choice. And I thought, no, actually, this is not what I want to do. This is going against my values. I was hired for my values, for the shared values I have with my C level as well. So this is not okay. So what I did is decided to go see my C-level and speak up. It was very simple, just came up and said, actually, I'm not okay with this. We're not good in that area. And actually, I was a victim of a discrimination case because I was a woman. So, and so that, me speaking up resulted in a very good outcome at different levels. First of all, we went back in that room. The C-level changed completely, was very transparent, came, you know, acknowledged that, you know, they just got caught off guard, but they have a plan, and they did have a plan for it to get better. We won the investment. We implemented changes in the company, and it was way better. But also, in that room, the C-level got our admiration and our respect because they managed to admit that they had made a mistake in their reaction, but also they were very transparent, even in front of an investor, which was a big deal. All this to say that was an example I gave to show that even people who are high or in specific roles like compliance, which is a very specific role here, we should speak up and show the example. And so leaders should lay the groundwork so that everyone follows. And that starts with delivering honest feedback, honest opinions, so that people can also go next step and deliver honest concerns or wrongdoings. So that was the second pillar. The third one is regarding reassurance, which is, I think, the most challenging one from my perspective. It's being able to have employees who feel comfortable sharing and not feel ridiculed or, you know, fear retaliation. Having the principle, the stamp, non-retaliation principle on your policy is just not enough, right? You need to show it. And that goes through behavior, but also culture shift. You need to have a culture of safety. And that goes through tolerance, tone from the top. And they need to mean it, right? You need to have a company who wants to be ethical. If not, it's not going to work. It needs to come from the management, pushed by compliance, of course, pushed by people departments, but it should come from the top. And you need that culture shift. You also need to deliver positive messaging around speaking up and whistleblowing. And that should be constant, right? It's teamwork. It's we're all in. It's a common problem that we need to solve. And if you do speak up, you're doing it for the good of people. It's because you have empathy. It's because you care about your colleagues. It's all the positive messaging around it. Obviously, yes, we do have cases, you know, big scandals where they took huge risks. But the majority of cases, it doesn't even go to legal, actually, it stays internal. And for those cases, we should really work on speaking up. And what works here for reassurance, what I saw at least in smaller structures, it's maybe more difficult in a big organization, but in a small, medium company, is showing the people who are behind the tool, behind the investigations. Obviously, everything should be based on process, and that's the key element. But if people see the compliance officer and that person is not that scary, and they're actually here to listen, and they do care about you, and they will take everything you say seriously, that will push speaking up. It's related to the point I made earlier about meeting people, you know, face-to-face. So that's for the reassurance, but obviously this is a daily effort. It's loads of communications, showing your face as well, and it should come from all areas. So, and that goes for also training. So obviously you have the online training, but it's also training managers to raise that trust and that different culture, especially in quick developing companies. When they go from startup to medium size, they don't necessarily have time to work on that. They should, right? Culture shift is super important. Often, you know, they start as a pirate, where they're just trying to conquer everything and get, you know, as much money, but also, you know, more presence on the market. But as a company grows, they need to shift that culture and go in more of a Navy mentality, where there's more structure, more processes, but also more concern about how we do things, right? So it's not only implementing a procedure, it's actually how we do processes. So that was for the third pillar. The last pillar is taking action. There are so many instances where, especially in smaller organizations, where people decided to speak up, but nothing was done after. No action was taken. And often it's because people who received the case, so often, you know, it would be a compliance officer or HR, because compliance teams are not always built at the beginning. We often come after, who think that the concern is not big enough, right, or not important enough, or they don't see the issue. What is important here is to understand that something could be minor or non-existent for one person, but could be major for another, right, depending on who you are, your background, your experience, you know, there's so many different elements to it that you need to take into account. And as an HR or compliance professional in particular, you should not make a distinction. So no problem is too little, basically, to be escalated. And you need to show that you care. So if someone comes to you and says, look, you know, I saw something or something happened to me, I think it's wrong, thank them. Even if it's a non-problem, actually, in the end, thank them for raising it. Right. So often we just forget the basics, but just thank them not for bringing a huge case, thank them for actually getting the courage to speak up, because it does take courage and not a lot of people are willing to do it. So for those who do, we need to really thank them. Once they've done that and they're explaining what happened to them, we also need to have a different approach. So having a positive approach, of course, after thanking them, you need to listen to what they say. Never, you know, stop them from talking. Never say, yes, but, because that negates everything they're saying. If you have questions, ask them, yes, but it's only to get more details. It's not to challenge what they have to say, right? As often these cases as well, unethical cases, are very emotional. So you have people who, you know, who are crying or, you know, not thinking, you know, rationally, and that is fine. And that's why their explanations as well are not very clear. But it's a space. It should be a safe space for them to speak. So let them and then go back and ask questions. And then once the, you know, the investigation is launched, I often saw as well cases where the reporter is left in the dark. So sometimes investigations are very quick, so it's easy, but sometimes they take a long time, a few months. And so if you have someone who built the courage to speak up and doesn't hear back for a month, that is stressful for them because they're like, oh no, did I do something wrong? Am I gonna lose my job? Is something gonna happen to me? And so you need to update them. I'm not saying you need to tell them exactly what you're doing, right? Especially in, under investigation, but you need to update them saying, you know, I haven't forgotten about you. I am working on this. Don't worry. I'm questioning a few people, trying to gather more evidence. I will keep you updated as I go, right? And that's super important in order to keep that person away from any fear, right, from speaking up. And same, when you close a case, update. Obviously, often it's, you know, it's done, but you also need to keep that updating. So the last point I'll make here is regarding, so reward is obviously speaking to them, but there's also a new thing that we're that's happening in the US especially, and that we're discussing in the UK is tangible rewards. I haven't implemented it, and I'm looking into it, so that's food for thought for everyone here. I'll just finish off this chat by saying that we as compliance professionals and also people professionals should always try to aim higher. I'm obviously not saying we should, you know, climb the Everest, but we should always try to be better. We should grow with the company, work on our comms, work on the process, be there for the people, be better at it. And we should also be more action-focused. Often as compliance officers, we think about training, have people completed the training. Obviously, that's a basic, and you need to do it, and well done, but that's not it. You shouldn't stop there. And you should really focus on, you know, rewarding people who are actually stepping up, and really showing what integrity is. And that's how you will become an ethical company and an even better company.